Well, it is a real treat to bring three people that both personally and professionally really I really admire on stage with me to have a discussion. But before we kick off, I wanted to tee up a quick video because we all, you know, we've heard a lot of talking, and it's time to watch a little video to sort of get us into the mood for the discussion we're going to have. So maybe over to the video.
There is a growing consensus that the People's Republic of China may try to use force against Taiwan in pursuit of its One China policy. A massive military modernization program, access to cutting-edge commercial technology, more realistic training, advances in artificial intelligence, and territorial expansion in the South China Sea has made China a more technologically advanced and capable adversary than ever before.
In just a few decades, Taiwan's semiconductor...
For years, Taiwan has lived under the threat
of... The U.S. military would be called on to defend Taiwan.
Taiwan as tensions escalate.
While some of these actions may be symbolic, they carry significant risk of escalation. These developments put enormous pressure on the United States and other countries that seek to deter China's aggression in the region. Software has a critical role to play in fielding a complete picture of the battle space, facilitating collaboration on complex courses of action with mission partners, leveraging commercial and national satellite constellations, unlocking AI-enabled decision-making at the edge, and breaking through the noise to extract signal in disadvantaged, disconnected, and degraded environments. Software can help deliver decision-making advantage to deter and defend.
All right. I'm going to first start off with my good friend, Oriana. You just returned from Beijing, just very shortly.
Yes.
Number of discussions with the People's Liberation Army. I wanted to get a sense of sort of, from your perspective, what is Beijing trying to achieve? What is it? What is their intent? What do they want to achieve, particularly in the Western Pacific, that we should be concerned about?
So I think for anyone who looks at China, studies China, speaks Chinese, reads what they write, listens to what they say, they've actually been extremely clear about what their intentions have been. I think probably 15 years ago, I started giving talks on stages like this that the Chinese want to be the dominant power in Asia, and they want the U.S. military gone. And when I was in Beijing talking about these issues 15 years ago, I think most of them felt like, what a waste of time to invite this professor, because she is telling us something that we all know. It's like coming to the United States and being like, they have three branches of government. And it's like, okay, they pay you over there for that kind of analysis. But I think generally speaking, this idea that we could convince China they're better off being number two because we provide some public goods that never flew there. They really want what they call strategic space, which is the ability to make decisions that they feel are best for them without having to worry about how other countries respond. And part of that is what we see as deterrence is constraints for them. And so they want that gone. Now, I think, you know, we can open it up to the debate about whether they want that level of military power globally, of which I personally believe they want to rely mainly on political and economic tools to achieve their goals beyond Asia. But without a doubt, they want to be the dominant military power in that region.
And so how would you evaluate sort of the military balance, looking at it from the perspective of Beijing? What do you see as the military balance? And to what degree is there sort of mix of both sort of hardware and software play in the way in which they approach this?
So I think that the number one thing with the Chinese military modernization is, besides it going extremely quickly, it has been really successful in a number of key areas. So when you look at the hardware component of it, when I first started looking at the Taiwan Strait balance, for example, my first job out of college, I co-edited a book on the topic. And this was in the mid 2004, 2005, where their invasion plan was to commandeer a bunch of ships and try to paddle their way over. You know, one of the first papers I presented was on their destroyer. They got the first ship-based defenses. So back in the day, there wasn't a lot of concern, but the Chinese focused very heavily on modernizing their forces. So their services had about 0 to 4% of modern equipment. Now the majority of their equipment is modern. Then they focused on building a lot of it, right? So now we know they have more ships than the U.S. Navy. And in the last 10 years, the focus has really been on this soft component, right? So it's not just the equipment they have and how much of it they have, but Xi Jinping did an evaluation of his forces and came to a conclusion that probably Putin should have come to before he invaded Ukraine. He said to his military, you guys have a lot of fancy stuff. I don't think you know how to use any of it. And a big component of that is what the Chinese refer to as sort of informationized, informationalized war, depending on how you want to translate Xinhua. And so they then wanted not only the capability to impact U.S. forces, but the capability to project power themselves. And a big component of that was building this C4ISR structure. The software and digital aspect of this is really key from a perceptions, deterrence, and escalation perspective. You know, I am not someone who is an expert in technology, more of how technology impacts decision making. This modernization process was largely geared to making sure the military could conduct joint operations. And the only thing right now that is keeping China from using force against Taiwan is that they don't feel that in the soft modernization sense, in terms of the caliber, quality, and training of their military, they're ready yet. They don't feel like they're ready to execute a joint operation. A big component of this has to do with the lack of faith in decision-making. There's a number of reasons for this. You know, the system is very centralized. They used to do a pay-to-promote situation, which made it seem like, should I listen to the person above me? But they've always been very focused on centralizing control over ISR strike and support functions. They want that human-machine interaction to make it so they are confident in decision-making. So while the United States, we want people in the loop, right? And we feel calmer and happier when people are making the decisions. The Chinese are really excited about the prospect of, you know, software machines making those decisions for them so they don't have to rely on their people. And so the concern is as they go more in that direction to digitize their military, regardless of the actual capabilities, they are going to become more and more confident in their ability to execute the types of operations that they might need to against Taiwan, which will make them harder to deter.
So that's pretty concerning. Scott, I'm going to turn to you. I mean, you've spent a career sort of looking at these things. From your perspective, you know, first of all, I mean, what is the United States trying to achieve? And then sort of, you know, are we prepared to deal with the kinds of challenges that Oriana has sort of laid out here?
So we've got a couple of hours, is that right?
Yeah. We got 37 minutes.
So it's complicated. It comes to where do you start in answering a question like that. And I think where it starts is where you sit. One of the advantages that I have with now being out of uniform is people expect me to bring a military perspective, and I actually try to diminish the military perspective and talk about how critical it is that we look at this competition that we're having with the PRC from a whole of government perspective. It was interesting, I paused when you asked Oriana the question about the balance of power, of military power. That's important, and it's important to keep track of, but I think it's more important to keep track of the balance of power between U.S. national power and PRC national power. On the discussion of how do we manage our power, I think we have to do better. This is the first time that we've truly been in a peer competition with another country. And I don't think that we're being thoughtful enough about it. So I guess in answer to your question, what is the U.S. strategy? My answer is I'm not sure. It appears to be a strategy of knitting together a bunch of actions and tying those into a broader strategy. To Oriana's point, I really think this competition is really about the international rules-based order and the mechanisms that we use to manage power across free and open Pacific, to channel Prime Minister Abe, and as liberal democracies. So we have our differences, but we have a rule set that to govern how we resolve those differences on the national stage. And as I'm channeling you a little bit, I may be misquoting you or giving you words that are not directly that you commented on, And that is that the PRC is not comfortable with that. It's a control mechanism. I'll use AI as an example that Oriana again touched to. It's a really interesting debate that we're having in the United States, back to your question of what is our strategy. I do think that the PRC is embracing AI as a critical tool to help them get after the objectives that Oriana spelled out. But it's a control tool. You know, a comment that I made to someone earlier is that PRC thinks of AI as a way to control the force, if you're talking about a military perspective, or control the people, if you're talking about a civil perspective, or to control the government, if you're talking about a government perspective. My view on AI, part in answering your question of things that we need to do, we need to think of AI as a way to free the force, to free the people, and to free the government. That's not just a turnkey. You don't just go do it. And I think the debates that are going on in this town are critically important. But I think our approaches are very, very different. In the interactions that I've had with PRC counterparts, it is all about control. The ability the comment that you mentioned, decision advantage. Decision advantage is baked into liberal democracies, and more so of the United States than anywhere else. Our ability to delegate authority comes naturally to us in our academic institutions, in our government institutions, and in our military institutions. But more than that, our ability to delegate authorities while retaining responsibility for the decisions made, that was my fault, I shouldn't have delegated those authorities to you. It is antithetical to how the PRC thinks, how the PLA operates. So I think it's a great question, but I would be careful about rushing to an answer. I think there needs to be a broader debate, not only with this country, but with our allies and partners, in the context of what is it that we should be doing to counter the threat to the institutions that have been established for so long that is brought by both Russia and the PRC.
So Carrie, you've been looking at this stuff for years now. What should be some of our priorities as we sort of are looking at this interplay between both, you know, Beijing pursuing really a set of objectives that fundamentally threaten kind of the way in which we think the international system should be ordered and the way in which power should be shared, and what should be some of the things that we should be wrestling with here in DC? I know you certainly look at this every day in your think tank role, and you certainly got to wrestle with it inside the department. So some of your thoughts.
Well, I'm a little worried here because we have the retired admiral that talked about policy strategy, and now you're going to have the policy wonk talk about military issues.
Of course,
so,
yes.
I don't know. But, you know, back to your earlier discussion with Oriana, from everything that I've seen and from the scholarly work that she and others have done, I mean, China, they do want to win without fighting. Nobody wants to have to make that decision to send thousands upon thousands of young men and women into battle to die. You know, China is, they believe they are in catch-up mode. And so you see language coming out of their documentation. We want to match, you know, I'd say we want to surpass. And I do agree. I think, you know, there's a military component there, but their broader global ambitions, they are very much economic in nature. And so we now have this challenge, I think, unlike we did in the Soviet era, where it was much more of a military competition. Now we have this nexus between the military, national security, and economic security. However, you know, if Xi makes that political decision, he's not going to go in with one arm tied behind his back. I mean, he is going to want to maintain that battlefield advantage and keep the United States out. So it's things like countering our C4ISR, countering our mobilization and logistics abilities, perhaps targeting our critical infrastructure to degrade our will here at home. So those are the things that I would be looking for. I think from a U.S. perspective, some of our priorities, we need to be able to keep that state of deterrence, deter the conflict from happening. I really liked Deputy Secretary of Defense Hicks. She gave a speech a couple of weeks ago where she basically made the comment, today is not the day. And this was something that we thought a lot about when I was in the department as well, is what's in your toolkit to get Xi to wake up every day and think, not today. I can't take on the U.S. and its allies. They're too strong. And my forces aren't ready. So what are the things that we can do there? And I do make a bit of a linkage here, and we can probably talk about it later, between what's happening in Ukraine and Taiwan is it important for China to see Putin lose. It's important for them to see the cost that a smaller country can impose on a larger one, especially when they have a will to fight. It's important for them to see degraded, you know, what happens with the, you think it's a vaunted military and it's much less than what was thought. And then I really like the comments earlier on control. I mean, China has this system where it's very rigid in their command and their control, and what you're seeing on the Ukrainian battlefield is much more operational adaptability and flexibility. You know, one of the things that really weighs on me is it is just the urgency. And whether you believe 2027 or not, I mean, there is an urgency here that we need to be more prepared. Again, show that strength, get Xi to think, not today. What I'm struck by, though, is that largely means you're fighting with the toolkit that you have today. I mean, our systems just take so long, the hardware takes so long to develop. So that's really where I focus more on the integration and the software piece. How do you stitch together those capabilities that you have today, including commercial, and how do you automate those really manual processes? And, you know, in the ISR world, I mean, I go into different ops centers, having the Project Maven team, which was superb under me, there were a lot of manual processes that we still undertake that software automation, machine learning could really speed up and help us in a time of conflict.
So I think you're absolutely right. This sort of belief of, you know, how do we persuade Xi Jinping that today is not the day to roll the iron dice is sort of, it sits at the centerpiece of sort of where the United States is. So maybe, and I'm, you know, we change this up a little bit. Oriana, what would convince Xi Jinping that today is not the day, right? I mean, so I think, you know, we've all been sort of searching for this sort of like, what is sufficient deterrence? What does that look like, and how do we do that? Particularly when, you know, they are certainly outproducing us in the number of ships. They're certainly outproducing us in the number of aircraft. So if we think about sort of the hardware that makes up military power, it seems like we're not necessarily on track to persuade them that today is not the day.
Well, I think the important thing here is about sort of risk acceptance and risk aversion. You know, my assessment of the Chinese system is actually they're quite cautious. I mean, we look at it from the outside, we see that control, we see a heightened sort of willingness to use violence. I remember when I was in Beijing during some of the Hong Kong protests, some of my Chinese colleagues were like, why do you keep on saying that Xi Jinping was so brutal in Hong Kong? He didn't kill everyone. Like, he could have done that, and he didn't. Like, why isn't that the news story? So it's like they kind of look at these things slightly differently than we do. And so when it comes to Taiwan, I like to say that the war is inevitable, but we can delay it forever. Along those lines of today is not the day. I have no brilliant ideas of like how to solve it. But in my assessment, what was really the main pathway to war is that once the military is ready, it is possible. It is not a miscalculation. It is a calculation that they could potentially take Taiwan very quickly before the United States can really mount a significant defense. And then we're in this political space where, you know, what's the U.S. president going to do then? Once the Taiwan president has capitulated, is a U.S. president going to declare war on China? So there's always these distinctions in our system between operationally what is possible and, like, politically some of the problems there. So I see that, you know, for Xi Jinping, if it looks like he can't have that quick victory right now, because internally they assess they have serious disadvantages in protracted warfare, and there are the costs associated with a protracted conflict with the United States are too high and could potentially undermine what they refer to as national rejuvenation. So if they don't have that quick victory option, I don't think they're going to do it. Now, slight caveat, as Matt mentioned, I just got back from a week of meetings in Beijing. And it was interesting because the party and the military supported my trip, so I got some really great meetings and access. But you always have to think, like, why did they do that? You know, like, what is it that they're hoping that I get out of this? To keep in mind how I evaluate.
No China watcher ever thinks that.
Right.
No one is ever suspicious of the.
Of like, what do you want me to get out of? And besides, I'm supposed to come back and tell everyone, don't worry, they're not going to arrest you and throw you in jail. They're like, you aren't in jail. Everything was fine. You're not, you know, go tell your friends. The other sort of message is, because I write about this likelihood of war, it was very clear that they wanted me to believe that they would never use force. And they wanted me to come back to the United States because they're like, Chinese people don't kill Chinese people. And I'm like, well, what was that whole civil war about? And they're like, oh, not that one. But in the end, like, what I took from it is, and this is somewhat of a new idea, but I'm going to express it publicly anyway, there is another pathway to war that I haven't given a lot of thought to that makes me very concerned. And that is, when Xi Jinping has said that he wants progress towards reunification, I had a lot of discussions with people about what that means. I always thought, as long as Taiwan doesn't declare independence, or the United States like doesn't put nuclear weapons in Taiwan, or something like that, you know, China is not going to use force outside of the scenario that I laid out. They're not going to risk a protracted war. But what it seems to be the case that they currently believe U.S. policy is what it says in the communiques, which is that we support whatever happens as long as it's a decision made across the strait. And they're starting to get suspicious that the U.S. actually prefers the current status quo, Taiwan's de facto independence. They don't believe that yet, but they're starting to get suspicious that the United States prefers for Taiwan not to be a part of China. Now, I don't think it's controversial to say, and of course I didn't say it in the room, that like, I think they're right. Like, I, you know, when they lay it out, they're like, well, you say it's an unsinkable aircraft carrier and we can threaten you in the second island chain, but that would be the case regardless if it happened peacefully or not. So are you saying it would be a problem if Taiwan was a part of China? You know, and I'm like, well, that's kind of a problem. So when we talked about that, then they started to say, well, if it were the case that that was U.S. policy, then there's no level of military power that will deter us. Then, you know, I had Chinese counterparts be like, you will lose. Like, we will fight until sort of the end. And so this has made me, you know, start to think that we need to, you know, I believe the military deterrence is very important. The Chinese don't mention that at all when they mention all the things they're upset about. When I ask them, like, you know, why do you think we're changing the status quo in Taiwan, they list all the political stuff. And they're like, oh, you know, congressional visits, passing of these laws. And I really have to directly ask, like, what about the new base in the Philippines? What about the additional forces in Southwest Japan? And then they're like, oh, yeah, I guess we don't like that either. But it's not the main thing in their mind, which makes me think we have a lot of space to really enhance this military deterrence, which will help us. We always think military is provocative, political is not. But in my view, it's actually the opposite in this scenario, that we need to build up our military in the region, and we need to tone it down on trying to expand Taiwan's political space.
Which will be very difficult, given an election season in Taiwan and everything else.
And right. In the United States. It is a politically fraught situation. This is one of the great things about being a tenure-track professor, is that, like, I can say to policymakers, you know, like, President Biden, you should really make a statement that you're not against peaceful reunification. I think he should do that. Is the U.S. president going to do that? No. Which makes this alternative way of preventing this war happening, I don't know, more difficult. I just haven't come up with the pathway to peace in that scenario quite yet.
Yeah. So what you're saying is we've got a difficult job ahead of us on maintaining deterrence. Mm-hmm. So maybe, Scott, from your perspective, you've talked a little bit about how, from a U.S. perspective, how we view artificial intelligence and software, and certainly a long experience and on the hardware side of this. What's the sort of mix that we should be thinking about from the capabilities that we have coming online today from commercial industry and the existing capabilities we have? What does that look like in being able to be able to sort of maintain the perception in the minds of our potential adversary that this will be extremely difficult for you, and therefore that military option is something that you should be looking for other ways to be able to resolve this problem?
So let me answer that question first by answering your previous question. I think Xi Jinping gets up every morning and says, today's not the day. How do we get him to keep thinking that?
Yes.
That gets to the deterrence piece. If they decide to move, my bet is the trigger will occur internal to China itself, or they will take advantage of an external challenge that the U.S. and potential our allies and partners face, and choose to move not necessarily against Taiwan, but perhaps in the South China Sea as a test of commitment and resilience, before they actually moved on Taiwan. But moving Taiwan is all about the stability, in my mind, of the Chinese Communist Party and that system that they've established to further their power. So the term, in directly answering your question that comes to my mind, is relevant. So there's two sides to the deterrence coin. One side is deterrence, and the other side is relevant. So we don't do enough assessments of deterrence. We say these things that and we do these things, and we put them under the rubric of deterrence. And we never go back and do the assessment, does it actually deter them? So the arguably the U.S. has stepped back from allies and partners in recent history, at least in their perspective. And the result of that has been, I think, fairly positive, perhaps not by design, but we've got the free and open Asia-Pacific from Prime Minister Abe. We've got Australia that stepped forward in really meaningful ways and making a difference to sustain the stability in the region. It certainly is a deterrence factor. And it's relevant because the PRC is reacting to it. You've got the rejuvenation of EDCA in the Philippines. I mean, I could go on and on of these various efforts. The Japanese budget and what they're funding for their own national security, the measures that they're taking and the tools that they're putting into their self-defense force toolbox is significant. They're partnering with Ukraine in meaningful ways. I could make the same comments about Korea. These are impactful. These are all beyond just the military component. I think Kerry mentioned this about how critical a sense of urgency is. I'm really not interested in 2027. And because it could happen sooner. You know, I've owned a house in San Diego for 35 years and I've had fire insurance. I can't wait for that thing to burn down so I can get a return on all that fire insurance that I've paid for it. But I pay my taxes so the fire department is ready to respond. That's what the military does. It's that insurance policy that if we get it wrong. So the way to get it right is to get engaged, back to your question about strategy, and to leverage, as was commented in the presentation just before us, is the commercial sector, because the commercial sector can move fast. And the solution is, the first solution to reach for is the software solutions, and to optimize the systems that we have now. To your point, we're gonna have to fight with what we have. We need to look further out as well. Optimize those systems to how we fight collectively. And when I talk about we, I talk about allies, partners, and friends. Now, Secretary of Defense has been beat up over integrated deterrence. I'm a believer in it. I'm not sure what it is, but that's okay, because I think there's great value in talking about how we can partner with like-minded liberal democracies to counter a threat that's common to us all. And all of us bring various tools. The software piece of this is absolutely critical, built in the context of how we fight collectively. I mean, it's going to be different than it was in Iraq and Afghanistan, but it's going to be the same. Iraq and Afghanistan, the successes there was based on this ability to delegate authorities down to the squad level and have them operate without direct oversight of exactly what they were doing day to day in the field. Broad oversight of objectives and effects that they were supposed to create over a two-week period. Software can speed that up. It can eliminate those things that are not worth dealing with, giving us critical insights of what to focus on. And it can say, these areas have the highest level of return. This will be an asymmetric fight. I think Matt mentioned this. One of our greatest challenges is logistics. We have a huge exposed logistics train to support a fight in the Western Pacific. PRC's logistic lines, they're all internal lines, and they're all very short, very difficult to get after them. This is really about leveraging software to optimize the systems that we have now and inform the acquisition process for the systems that we should be pursuing in the near term as well as the future.
Yeah. So, Kerry, I mean, you got to work with some of these sort of nascent systems as they were coming online. Can you describe a little bit about, you know, how you've brought some of those things to bear and where you think some progress is coming along that's going to help us with this?
So I want to hit that, but can I build off the deterrence question too? Is, you know, I think of it in terms of what are our competitive advantages and how do we play to those while minimizing our vulnerabilities? And so, you know, I would maybe offer three thoughts on that. One is, we still have exquisite capabilities I mean, I know they're expensive and they take a long time to build, but, you know, I want to keep Beijing second-guessing on what we can really do, and we have some pretty phenomenal capabilities up there. I think the challenge going forward now is trying to figure out that mix between the really exquisite expensive and some of these newer, you know, kind of mass volume expendable capabilities. But then also, how do you integrate both together? And then the second piece for me is it's the adaptability and it's the innovation piece. Back in 2018, that national defense strategy, there's a line in there that says success no longer goes to the country that develops a new technology first, but rather to the one that better integrates it and adapts its way to fighting. So whether it's your existing toolkit that you're just using differently or putting new things out into the field quicker, it's a mix of the technology and then the con-ops piece. And then the allies and partners piece that Scott mentioned. You know, they are expanding their capability. I was just in Japan last month. I mean, there is a phenomenal window of opportunity right now as they are on the space front. They're talking about space and security in the same sentence, which they hadn't done prior. They're increasing their defense spending. They're emphasizing counter-strike weapons. I mean, this is a very different kind of, you know, Japan policy strategy than we've seen previously, and it's being driven by China, by North Korea, by what they're seeing Russia do to Ukraine. So there's a great opportunity with the allies and partners. On the kind of what I saw, and first I have to say, I mean, I was the person sitting in the E-ring. I mean, it was the team. It was Jack Shanahan, Drew Kukor, others that did Project Maven that have, and their team that they get all the credit for it. But what I really liked, and I'll use that as a particular example, and I know Palantir was heavily involved in that, was they started with a problem. Like, what is just a burr in your behind that you really need to solve that's consuming just manual labor hours? And the problem that they started with was full motion video, these young men and women staring 24/7 at video screens and manually classifying what was in the screen. I mean, God, what a perfect thing for machines to do. So starting with that operational problem and then going out and seeing kind of who can best solve this problem and not going and picking one, but setting up these 6-month sprints, bringing in a variety of companies, kind of letting free market and free competition play out, and the best ones that can actually deliver a beta product that we can get out in the field.
Which we couldn't have predicted from the get-go.
No, but I'll tell you, know, the last thing I'll say on that too, what really struck me is it was less about the code. I mean, what, 5% of the problem with AI, you know, department adopting AI, it's not the algorithms, it's the front end. It's getting access to the data, cleaning it, training it, figuring out how you bring in unclassified folks to train on classified data sets. It's the security piece of it. And then it's the back end, is once you've got it in place, how do you integrate it in your weapon systems, in your workflows? I mean, even the
staff functions.
Yeah, I mean, it was still a sidecar for a long time because they culturally just couldn't get it integrated in the workflow, but that's where it's really going to pay off.
Yeah. So Oriana, Kiri brought up Japan's innovations, and I maybe wanted to touch real quick. What does that doing to Beijing's calculus as Japan makes really very significant moves? How does that play out in their minds? What does this look like for them?
Well, I think if you look at sort of the Chinese military calculus beyond the Taiwan problem, you know, they are much, much less confident, and rightfully so, in their military capabilities than any other contingency. They can't really project power effectively against the United States in the South China Sea, one given that they start, you know, the farther they move away from mainland China, the more they have some of the same vulnerabilities when it comes to logistics, reliance on space assets, and things that we do. You know, so I think it's not that military capabilities predicts everything. You know, that's why I look a lot at Chinese behavior and discourse as well. But it can tell you a lot. You know, we didn't have an issue in the South China Sea with the Chinese military before, 2009 or so, because they couldn't really operate there before. So I, you know, when I was in China, they love to say, like, well, we've never used force against Taiwan before. It's been, you know, 75 years, and we've just been hanging out over here. And I'm like, well, you never could before. Can we all sort of admit that? So if you get into, like, what Japan is doing, I think we are definitely in a very stable deterrence scenario when it comes to China and Japan, for example. The Japanese, I was there meeting with their leadership a couple months ago, are very concerned about a Chinese attack on the Senkakus, trying to take Okinawa. You know, I personally, you know, the Senkakus, if China takes Taiwan, the Senkakus are gone. I mean, China's 100% gonna take the Senkakus. But for the rest of Japan, I am not concerned. I mean, I've never heard or read or anything about the Chinese deciding that, you know, they think, you know, that they really are going to take Okinawa. But it is useful that they have these concerns because it is making them invest much more in their military capabilities to defend themselves. And this is indirectly useful. For one, the United States can focus more on some of the contingencies we need to focus on and rely more on our Japanese partners. Two, there is no doubt in my mind that if we do get into a state of conflict with China, the Chinese hit our bases in Japan, 100% Japan is in. And even if they don't do that, if there's a conflict between China and the United States, 100% Japan is going to let us use our assets in Japan. So that's the good news story. But the slightly less good news story is that this, what Japan is doing, is all about the defense of Japan. They are not interested in defending Taiwan. That seems like a nuanced point, and it might not come out in a lot of the statements because they'll be like, we're all behind you, United States. And you're like, what do you mean? And they're like, well, of course, when China attacks Taiwan, they will at the same time attack the Senkakus. And so then that will trigger our involvement. And I'm like, there is no way that China's going to do that. So then I sort of qualify, and I'm like, so if they only attack Taiwan and they don't attack the Senkakus, well, you know, then Taiwan's on its own. So I kind of am concerned about some of those scenarios. But, you know, all else being equal, having the Japanese, you know, improve their capabilities, same with the Australians, the more integration between our militaries. In going to what Admiral Swift said, this is not just military-focused. The Chinese care first and foremost about economics. Mm-hmm. The reason I don't talk about economics is because I feel like it's very hard, even for a president, to have control over everything. Like, would it be great for the United States to be the dominant economic power in Asia? Yes. Do I know how to do that? No. So I kind of stay in my lane. But the Chinese, their number one trading partners are U.S. allies and partners. Europeans. If the Europeans would just put some costs on the Chinese for their relationship with Russia, for all the stuff they're doing, China wouldn't do it. The problem is we have a collective action problem in the economic realm that's making that difficult. But, you know, it is good. The Chinese are paying attention. They see our allies and partners getting on board. When I was in Beijing, I asked, why do you think this is the case? Hint, I think it has to do with your lack of restraint. But they're like, no, it's because the United States, you force them to do these things. And so then I say, you know, we tried to force the South Koreans and the Japanese to meet and coordinate for decades. Why do you think we were so successful now? And we weren't successful in our hegemonic policies before. You know, you kind of have to use their language and go with it. And then they're like, oh, I don't know about that. But it does show that China is creating an international environment that makes it maybe more difficult for us in some ways, but increases the value of the United States as a partner.
Yeah. So maybe real quick, what do you suspect that they view as being our vulnerabilities? What are and Admiral Swift talked a little bit about the logistic, you know, just the sheer logistical terrain that this looks like. There is these seams between the U.S. and its allies that could be played upon. Mm-hmm. So those are two of them. Are there other vulnerabilities that they see from us that we should be having in mind, and the kinds of things that if we demonstrate the ability to shore up those vulnerabilities, presumably it adds to deterrence. Is there anything on that you can think of, and I kind of open up that to anyone.
The American people.
Absolutely.
Okay. Is the number one vulnerability they see. They'll be like, you know, the Chinese people, we can sure cool, we can eat our bitterness all day long. You guys are going to last 5 minutes, you know. And what I try to explain also to try to enhance deterrence, but what I think is true is in a war over Taiwan, if the United States does successfully engage in a timely manner, and then the Chinese kill Americans. Like, this isn't about Taiwan anymore. And, like, the American people's resolve about stuff, it, you know, changes depending on the scenario. But I think it's that combination of U.S. resolve, democratics, and this goes to the geography. It's not only that it takes us a long time to get there, it takes a long time for our decisions to make, for our leaders to make decisions. So they think they can confuse, to delay the decision-making calculus so that once we start deploying forces, and then we're really slow to get there, and then all of our allies and partners value, for the most part, economic engagement over security. Some of them are coming around to the security side, but most of them, you know, have these strategic partnerships with China, which they've signed, saying we won't let the politics get in the way. They all have a policy that Taiwan is a part of China, very different than Ukraine, because even Japan will say some of their laws of defense don't apply to Taiwan because Taiwan is not a country. You combine all of that, and they basically think they've got some political wedges with their allies and partners. They've got some the military superiority in terms of a quick conflict, and then in a protracted war, it's the American people.
Right. So I'm going to ask you all to kind of give some of your last thoughts before we turn it over to questions. But I wanted to maybe sum up a little bit here. We've got primarily a political deterrence issue that we're talking about, not necessarily a military one, right? So when we find ourselves in a position where we're having to deter, we're really deterring a political decision, and that encompasses all of sort of the national security power or all the national power on either side in the calculus going in. That fundamentally, if Chinese leaders decide that they feel they have to do this, they will have already made decisions about that they feel that they are in a good enough position militarily. So maybe, I mean, kind of open up to some last thoughts that you'd have to share with the audience before we go to questions. And so maybe, Carrie, I'll go to you first. Any last things you'd like to sort of communicate to folks?
So this may be more of a question than once Oriana gets to it, she can tackle it as well. Is, you know, I'm struggling right now because, you know, all the vector, the trend lines for China in terms of the military capability are all going up, the force structure, you know, more exercises, you know, air maritime incursions, you know, building more infrastructure, you know, kind of R&D infrastructure in country. So they now have the sustainment challenge. We've got to sustain this increasing military growth. At the same point in time, the economic and domestic headwinds that they're experiencing right now are tremendous. So are they going to continue to prioritize this military growth, or are we going to see that dial down in some respects? I think that's an open question. But then in terms of conflict, is that going to curb their appetite on potential, you know, conflict scenarios in the near term? Or, you know, if they look, things going kind of downhill in country, I'm going to divert and I'm going to do something before it starts to deteriorate too much. So that worries me. You know, on the technology front, I would say I would like us to elevate our discussion on technology to a more strategic level. You know, obviously, you know, clearly technology support mission, but when I think about kind of the broader stage here is the diffusion of technology. The U.S. isn't the only ones anymore, whether it's an AI computer, whatever, that has, you know, this kind of advanced capability. You know, many of these commercial companies are going to third parties and trying to sell it, and they're up against Chinese and other competitors, so it's not a sure thing that our companies will be able to win and be successful there. We still want to be the partner of choice in our technology. We still, you know, we want to have a robust industrial and innovation base, and that can't just be funded by taxpayer dollars. So, right. You know, we need to have that broader aperture, clearly protect technology, make sure it doesn't go to China, but at the same point in time, I think we need to open it up, and we need to take a hard look at our export policies, because this is just a different era and set of conditions than we had 40 years ago when we first created things like ITAR.
Absolutely. Scott?
Yeah, so quickly, I want to go back to stress that it really is the will of the people. I mean, that's what we should be most concerned about. I look at how critical software is. Cyber gets top billing. Interesting to me, not fascinating. I think cyber is a vector to get after software. I look at colonial pipeline. So think about it, if China moved on Taiwan and their first action with countering the United States was to shut down gas flow from fuel pumps all up and down, just up and down the East Coast. We had Russian hackers that did that. Where would the will of the American people be at that point, before any American lives were lost, to say, why is Taiwan so important to me? I can't get enough gas into my car to get home from work or to get to work. So we need to broaden our thinking about what the challenge is. I'm an optimist. I don't believe in 2027 because it could happen tomorrow, and we need to have a sense of urgency as what does tomorrow look like if that turns out to be reality. Allies and partners are stepping up and doing an incredible job. Japan is deterring China, period. Taiwan is deterring China because of the things that it's doing, but very limited. Australia is doing the same. Germany is back in the Western Pacific in a meaningful way. They've got issues with the EU and some limits as to what they can do, but they are back sending messages. Queen Elizabeth deployment from Great Britain into the Pacific. These are military actions, but that with them, there's a strong diplomatic piece behind this to say, we are supporting the international rules-based order. In the Pacific, it's the free and open Pacific. The power of that statement is it came from Prime Minister Abe It didn't come from the United States. So I'm optimistic, but I still got fire insurance on my house. We need a sense of urgency about this, and we need to take a broader look at it than just the military piece. And we're stressed on the military side. I'm not diminishing that like it's a slam dunk, and there's strong deterrence there. The last thing I'll say is we have to do a full assessment of the actions that we're taking that we think are deterrent. Are they deterrent in the minds of the PRC? And on the flip coin, are they reassuring to our allies and partners? Because there's a lot of things that we do in the name of deterring the PRC that our allies and partners would rather not have us do. We need to do an assessment of that impact, because are they as willing to support us if we're taking these actions that are counter to their own national interest? Wicked complicated, like I said.
All right, Oriana, I'm going to go to you, but folks in the audience, get your questions ready. So last thoughts before we turn to questions and answers.
So, I mean, the thing about the sense of urgency, I have to say that I've been working on China for a long time, and I know we talk about China a lot, but when you actually look at what's being done, it can be extremely frustrating. I mean, I can't tell you, obviously, I'm here in my civilian capacity, and only, you know, I do not speak on behalf of the Department of Defense or the Department of the Air Force, but 14 years working China in uniform, I can't tell you how many times I'm like, this is an idea I have, and they're like, great, 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 well, we'll have it ready in 20 years. I recently had this conversation about certain planning in which I was like, okay, I think we need to put together this different plan, and they were like, ugh, Major, you know, what do you know about life? You know how long it takes to put that together? And I was like, I don't, how long? And they were like, about 18 months of the whole planning cycle. They said, okay, what if China does this tomorrow? How long would it take for you to put together the plan? 3 days. Well, then just do it in 3 days, right? So the frustration of the sense of urgency is really there. And part of this is cultural. Part of it has to do with, I know we talk about software and it's very sexy and like weapon systems and equipment, but as someone in this system, I mean, the first place I want to see this is in the personnel system. And some of the largest costs for the Department of Defense, where all of our money is going, is on like personnel issues, you know, on how we deal with veterans, how we deal with education, how we deal with childcare. You know, I'm taking over command of a new unit at the Pentagon, which I'm supposed to come up with ideas of how to reassess all these policies, and it is hard. And so the bottom line is, yes, technology is really important, but given what's said here, it's also the quality of our people. Our quality of the people and recruiting, retaining and training the best people to get at these problems, that's what we need. And so we need some new arrangements to help people who are really good at technology to be spending more time getting at these problems, to help people who know a lot about China overcome some of the security barriers so they can help the U.S. government in these ways. And so I also hope that to see some, you know, besides obviously the technological innovation, which is very important, the organizational innovation that might be necessary for us to succeed in this area.
Very good. All right. First question: Who's going to be up first? Sir, right here.
I have a question for the Prime Minister.
I think we got a mic here.
Yeah, I have a question for you, Dr. Maestro. You mentioned at the beginning that the PRC will think about another alternative to war. Do you think is that the strategy that they may want to break society in Taiwan so it will just implode and take over?
So it seems that a lot of people in China are very confident that economics is more important than political freedom. Right? There's a lot of reasons for this, but whenever they evaluate like the issues in Hong Kong or what have you, they're like, you know, if we could just solve the housing crisis in Hong Kong, we wouldn't have these political problems in Hong Kong. In their mind, when people have the choice, they will choose economics over politics. Now, from the American perspective, that's hard for us to understand. Like, we look at the progression of how things are going in Taiwan, and it's hard to envision that the people of Taiwan decide that they want to be under the PRC without any sort of threat of kinetic action, right? So when I think that like peaceful reunification is impossible, that's why I think that very, very rarely do populations decide to give up those freedoms once they have it. From China's perspective, like, you know, they really think that if given the chance, they could sell this. You know, and they'll often bring up, for example, like, why, if it's not true, why are they so afraid to talk to us? If you think it's impossible for us to convince them through negotiations, then why are they refusing to even meet with us? So on one hand, to this reassurance component, it is useful for us, for China to still have faith that they can achieve their goals with Taiwan without using force. I don't think they can. But as long as they are confident in the power of their system and persuasion, they think they're going to be so great that like everyone's going to be, you know, want to be a part of that party. And they think the only thing standing in the way is that the United States is encouraging the DPP in Taiwan. You know, we're the ones causing the people of Taiwan not to want this, right? The trends show actually the opposite, that the less people have confidence in the United States, the more they identify with being Taiwanese versus Chinese. But the thing, you know, I like to say in Chinese language, there's only two words that I know of that are directly transliterated from English because there's no conception of them in the Chinese culture, and one of them is logic. So, like, as long as they remain convinced of those things, I think it's better for us.
Yeah, but I share your concern that them being convinced of that is beginning to break down, that they are
yes.
seeing many of those things in which it would appear that the Taiwanese people have made their own decisions, and that as that sinks in, that'll be very difficult and create real problems.
If I could just add a quick thing, which is I identified that before, that they are losing confidence in peaceful reunification, but it wasn't until this visit that I realized that they think the reason peaceful reunification won't happen is us.
Yeah.
I just thought it's because, like, I mean, of course it won't work. Who wants to be a part of China? But they think it's because of us.
Yep. Next question. All right, come on, folks. So we've solved everything. I know that's not true. Sir.
Mark Adams from Pearton. The question I have is more about us and less about China.
Mm-hmm.
And I have two kids that are in their 20s and early 30s. And most of us lived through the Cold War, Cold Wars, whether you want to call it one or two, it was continuation. And we all were pretty well convinced that to be on board with the whole idea that we needed to peace through strength, right? Ronald Reagan, my favorite president of all time. But I don't think that our younger generation is quite on board. Quite frankly. And I think that my question to leaders like yourself is, what do we need to do to help our younger generations understand the dire state of what this could mean to their future, to their kids' future, to the future of our republic? And also convince them that there are alternatives, but that peace through strength is actually part of that deterrence. So, yeah that's just my, again, and those are sort of my thoughts, but I'd love to hear
what this
group has to say.
So, anybody want to take that one to start with?
Yeah, I'll jump on it. I think Oriana may have mentioned it, maybe it was Carrie, but I think your comments are reflected in the challenge that the military has with recruiting right now. And so I would turn that around. I think what your question was, how do we help, you know, the young people of this nation understand how dire this is? I want to understand what they think about the situation. And what is the situation? Is it just Taiwan? That's why I say it's not about Taiwan. It's about the international rules-based order. So if the international rules-based order gets flipped and international rules-based order, it broadly is about discourse and dialogue to resolve differences as opposed to force and coercion. I think there's some strands that can be pulled with COVID and what the PRC response was to COVID, both when they shut the nation down and then when they rapidly open up. Both of them had huge consequences. Both of those were made from a nationalistic political position. So if that's what your vision of the system that governs the world of the future, then you should be careful. So I think how we tell the story to young people is really important. We need to be talking about this in universities. We need to be talking about it throughout academia. We need to be talking about it in the military. But unfortunately, our discussion, internal to the United States at least, is so polarized on this dimensions, it's very difficult to have these conversations within our families, much less within our society. this goes back to, I think, the thing all three of us agree in, our greatest vulnerability is national will. And I don't know what the answer is to your question other than to acknowledge it, that that is the primary question to ask. It's going to be too late if the bubble goes up and if attack happens on Taiwan. It'll be too late. The Japanese people have the same, the Japanese government has the same problem with its people. Korea has the same problem. Australia has the same problem. Why is this so important to me? We have to be able to answer that question.
Yeah, I mean, this is ultimately a fight for the what world we want to live in. It is. It's our values. It's the international order. And yeah, I've got young kids myself, and I don't know how to get the message through. I don't know how to really communicate that. I mean, a world order run by China's approach and their kind of system of governments is 180 degrees from how we approach things in terms of, you know, repression of you know, freedoms, individual rights, expression, you know, justice, surveillance, about 400 plus million surveillance cameras all over, social scores. If you're a minority, forget it, you're going to some internment camp. I mean, I just don't think that they fully understand really what we've lived in such a period of, you know, freedom and relative peace that they just don't understand what that alternative could look like. I mean, maybe we need a TikTok video to explain it and put on TikTok. I don't know.
I would say at Stanford, I teach this intro to international security course, right? So I have all these 18-year-olds, and we do this simulation. Before Ukraine, it was basically what happened with Ukraine. It was like a country A, country B, exact same scenario. And part of the scenario is you ask the students, like, what are you going to do? This other country has invaded your territory. What are you going to do? And they're like, I'm going to condemn them on Twitter. And then their social image will be, you know. And I'm like, they're like still invading you. Like, are you going to move any forces? And they're like, maybe it was a misunderstanding. And we should just see, like, if they're okay while they're invading us. I'm like, what is going on? You know, so on one hand, you know, I understand that kind of frustration. On the other, when I hear senior military leaders talk about some of the difficulties with, like, recruiting, retaining, I do think that a lot of our organizations are outdated and completely have failed to adopt. You know, the military still 99% is, like, situated for 1950s lifestyle in which, like, a man is the military member and they're followed around by their wives. You know, the fact that, like, women have to, like, fight to be able to have, like, breast pumps on military bases is absurd. So I get the senior leaders are always, like, toughen up. This is about the international order and everything. On the other hand, like, when, you know, I went through two pregnancies in uniform. It's really frustrating that you don't have the support that you need. And so I know of all sorts of people who are committed to the country that want to stay in but just, like, can't make it work. So I think there has to be a balance. And of course, telling people how important it is. You know, good relations with China, the way I think about it is, I like going to China. The world is a better place because our countries are interacting with each other. If we fight a war, besides the fact that it will be brutal, after that war, we will have no interaction between our two nations for the rest of my lifetime, if not lifetimes to come. And that is a fundamentally just sadder world for my children to grow up in than the one we currently do. But I think there has to be a give and take among the generations. Like, while there has to be a greater sense of maybe purpose and responsibility put on the younger generations, there also has to be a greater sense of adaptability that, you know, we live in a different age and they have different expectations of what they want to do with their lives and how they want to live their lives. And we need to be able to adapt to that.
Well, I would like to have all of you give a round of applause to our three panelists. It's a real treat. Thank you so much. We're going to clear up.